Orson Welles said, "We're born alone, we live alone, we die alone." But Orson, you are mistaken. Even when we think we're alone, we aren't. We are completely surrounded by microbes. They live on us, they live in us, they are everywhere. Every one of us is a multi-species collective. And with these microbes, we exist in symbiosis, a wonderful term that refers to different organisms living together. Animals and their microbes go through life in this long waltz, and some of these partnerships take hold at the moment of birth. Animals have many ways of passing their microbes on to their offspring. Here is a beewolf, an aptly named wasp, a fierce predator on the hunt for honeybees. This one's a female, and she's looking for food for her young. The beewolf stings the bee, but she doesn't kill it. She just paralyzes it. A dead bee would rot, but this way it stays nice and fresh. The beewolf drags the bee down into her burrow and lays an egg on it. And when the egg hatches, the grub starts to eat the bee alive. Once it finishes, the grub encases itself in a silken cocoon and starts transforming into an adult. So the beewolf mother has given the gift of a honeybee to her young. But it's not the only gift. Meet Martin Kaltenpoth. He studies beewolves.
Hey, Ed, how's it going?
Hi, Martin. So let's get right to the paste. Because when you were doing your PhD, your advisor noticed something weird about beewolves, that they secrete this paste from their antennae, like toothpaste coming out of a tube.
Yes, and that's really weird because no other insect is known to secrete such large amounts of stuff from the antennae.
And so why do the beewolves do this?
This is kind of an exit sign for the larvae to leave their cocoon and get out of the ground.
But there's more to the story, right? Because when you looked at the paste under a microscope, you saw something weird.
I still remember sitting there with my PhD advisor in his office. We looked at the pictures and we're like, wow, this is weird. This is full of cell-like structures. So there's some bacteria. And that was fascinating because it was completely unheard of in insect antennae.
So there were bacteria living inside the beewolf antennae, which is a strange place to call home, even for a microbe. What was it doing in there? No matter what it took, Martin was going to answer that question. He became obsessed by bacteria, which I can understand. He examined beewolves from around the world, and in every one, he found bacteria teeming in their antennae. And even more surprisingly, those antennae only contain one type of bacteria, Streptomyces.
It was amazing to see, wow, a Streptomyces, and then even to us as zoologists at that time, it did ring a bell. Because Streptomyces is so well known for antibiotic production, and we use it as humans, we use it for human medicine as well.
And that was a big discovery. Streptomyces is a vast group of bacteria, many of which are the source of antibiotics, the drugs that we use to kill other microbes. So the question became, were the Streptomyces making antibiotics that somehow benefited the beewolf? Martin spends a lot of time watching beewolves, watching their cocoons, their grubs, looking at their symbiotic bacteria under a microscope. And eventually, Martin found something. The fibers of the cocoon were saturated with the paste. The grub is covered in a protective blanket of Streptomyces. And it needs all the help it can get. For 9 long months, it's trapped in this warm, humid chamber that's perfect for nurturing fungi and bacteria, the kind that cause disease.
in the cocoon, it's pretty dark. So the larva is sitting there, lying there in the dark for about 9 months, and very lonely. So there is nobody to protect it, to help it.
Oh, except for the antibiotic-producing bacteria.
Exactly, yeah.
But that was just a hypothesis, right? So you didn't know if the antibiotic paste actually protected the young beewolf.
Not really. So the next step was testing whether the microbes indeed have a benefit for the beewolves.
So Martin divided beewolves into two groups. One he raised normally, with access to their paste, and the second he deprived of paste. And then he waited.
Yeah, I mean, I would check them daily and see how the larvae with and without bacteria were doing. I would never know whether they might still survive and emerge successfully.
So would the beewolves survive without their antibiotic paste? Well, almost all of the young beewolves that he deprived of paste died from infections. While those that had access to the paste, they usually survived. The results were crystal clear. By analyzing the chemistry of the bacteria in the cocoons, Martin's lab confirmed that they were indeed producing a cocktail of antibiotics. And the young beewolves exploit those chemicals to protect themselves from other microbes that might cause disease. But this is a two-way relationship. Those defensive bacteria might benefit too.
The antennae is like a nice and secure place for the bacteria because they get all the nutrition from the beewolf. So that's wonderful, a wonderful place to be. I mean, I don't know whether they're happy in there. They look happy, but that's a difficult question to ask a bacterium.
But how do those bacteria get into the antennae in the first place? Well, take a look at what happens when the young beewolf emerges from its cocoon.
Right before the beewolf female leaves its cocoon, it will rub its antennae against the cocoon surface and take up its bacteria, because it will need them later to give it to its young.
It's a bacterial inheritance to go along with the genetic inheritance. Kind of like us, we're not so different from beewolves. Humans also get our first microbes from our mothers. But we spend 9 months not in a cocoon, but in a womb. A chamber that separates babies from the outside world. And at birth, we unite with the world's microbes. Think of how significant that moment is. In just our first few seconds, we transform from just an individual into an entire world, a colony, a thriving ecosystem. And with every new experience, that ecosystem changes in ways that scientists are still trying to figure out. We pick up more microbes from our parents' skin, our mother's milk, the blankets we are swaddled in. We change and transform throughout our lives, and when the time is right, we pass on our microbes to our own children. None of us dances alone. We all contain multitudes. Thanks so much for watching this episode. To check out more microbe content, like articles and images, visit our Facebook page linked here. And if you're curious about your own microbiome, leave us some comments. I'll be back in a couple of weeks to answer your burning questions. See you next time.